Hi friends, welcome to the NPTEL course Leadership for India Inc. Practical Concepts and Constructs. We are in week 4 covering competency leadership. In this lecture, we will focus on the topic of learning to lead. The earlier lectures have focused on the key responsibility of leaders to develop others into leadership positions. A good leader helps others to learn and develop. This lecture focuses on the need for the leader to learn and develop himself or herself. One of the common perceptions of leadership within an organizational setting is as follows. 1. Leadership is a position of accomplished learning, experience, power, and visibility. A leader's responsibility is to provide learning inputs to various employees as part of his responsibility. It is not expected that leaders need to have their own learning inputs provided to them. Leaders are not even provided the space and time for reflection. This is the unfortunate situation as far as leaders are concerned with reference to learning and development. This is because leaders are expected to be available all the time. Leadership challenges abound all the time. Unknown expectations come up and also unknown challenges develop. The leader is considered far too accomplished to require any organized formal learning and development input. A leader's responsibility, therefore, is to break this stereotype with humility and also with confidence. There are, of course, some options which are available for leaders to develop. One option is to have short-term top management courses in Ivy League institutions in India or abroad. The second option is to network through positions of responsibility in industry federations. The third option is to invite external accomplished leaders or academicians to come and deliver courses within the organizational system. The fourth one is to have a fair level of interaction with directors on the board. While the above four are relevant methodologies to enhance learning and development by the leaders, they cannot substitute a formal methodology for learning and development both on work and off work. We need to find out a methodology which will accomplish this objective for the leaders. To be good learners and to become adept at self-development, leaders need to have two perspectives. One is an extrinsic perspective and another is an intrinsic perspective. In the VUCA world that we have, no matter how learned and accomplished one is, newer challenges always set in. So what are these extrinsic factors and what are those intrinsic factors? Externally, we need to be very clear how we would be able to manage the vision, strategy, execution paradigm because the environment is always changing. Second, assessing the outcomes with respect to goals in an industrial setting. And the other one is to receive and seek feedback on goals and outcomes. When we say extrinsic, it is about situation external to the leader. Intrinsic factors are as follows. Opening one's own window on external developments and benchmarks and keep watching and absorbing the external developments. Openness on the need for continuous learning on the part of leader. Focus on technology, business and competition as three principal domains for learning. The absence of the above perspectives is one reason why not all organizations, businesses and states are equally successful. In organizations where leaders are oriented both externally and internally on accepting, seeking and absorbing inputs for leadership development on a continuous basis, they act as role models from within. They act as role models for other team members, and virtual learning happens in that organization all the time, and therefore the organization would be more competitive and more agile relative to other organizations. I made a reference to VUCA. What is VUCA? Volatility, uncertainty, complexity and ambiguity. The world is considered a VUCA world. It is an acronym. Volatility is the nature to change rapidly and unpredictably, especially for the worse. Uncertainty is the inability to understand and predict quantitatively or qualitatively anything. Complexity is the multiplicity of factors impacting and the multiplicity of issues present in anything. Ambiguity, finally, is the lack of clarity, in fact, the presence of haziness surrounding any issues. These four factors come in any combination and with any level of emphasis on each of these factors. VUCA is something for which a leader has to be prepared all the time and prepare the organization because the environment is uncontrollable by and large. And to be able to handle VUCA, one has to be in a continuous learning and development mode. There is a HBR article on VUCA, which I have cited here. Let's look at the situation of complexity. Assuming that a transnational corporation wants to enter a complex emerging market where the regulatory framework is constantly changing, the tax laws would be very many, the regulatory enforcements would be very many, and the ease of doing would not be very high. In such a situation, the only thing which a transnational organization can do is to structure the company in a manner that the local environment is understood as much as possible by the subsidiary. The company also should do well to bring in specialists to advise them on the complexity that exists in that emerging market. Volatility. Volatility is the fluctuation of prices. Crude oil over the last several months has fluctuated between $120 a barrel to negative price, $0 a barrel. In such situation of volatility, you have to build in slack. You have to devote resources to handle unexpected volatility. After COVID-19 and the lockdowns, only the pipeline stocks could save the nation from going stock out on essentials. So the only way we can handle volatility and any unexpected emergencies is by having certain safety stocks all through the pipeline. These steps are typically expensive, but we have to accept that as the cost of doing business, and particularly a stable business. Another one is ambiguity. When we say ambiguity, we are not very clear which triggers what. The causal relationships are completely unclear. When you move into, again, emerging markets or markets which are yet to be developed, we are not very clear whether bringing in a high technology product would stimulate demand, or bringing in a medium technology or low technology product would have better acceptance. In order to be able to handle this ambiguity, leaders must have pilots conducted so that we understand the characteristics and the nature of the market. The fourth one is uncertainty. We can take an example of competition in the market. We may know that certain number of players are likely to be there in the market, but what would be uncertain is the strategy which each player would follow, more particularly with reference to price. When uncertainty is the hallmark of competition, we have to only invest in information. We have to invest in developing alternate plans. In the event that the pricing strategy adopted by competition is a price warriorship, how should we respond? Rather than respond after the activity is achieved by the competition, we have to be prepared well in advance with alternative plans. So to complexity, volatility, ambiguity, and uncertainty, leaders can still have answers provided they invest their time, effort, and money in these aspects. Another important thing is to treat VUCA as a combination of these four factors rather than as one single factor. Each element has to be addressed separately, and the resolution should be to bring down the unpredictability and enhance the certainty and predictability. And wherever certain things within the VUCA framework are predictable, address them separately. Wherever they are unpredictable, address them separately. And a strategy has to be in place, including Plan B, Plan C, and Plan D, along with risk reward analysis for each of the VUCA elements. To be able to handle the VUCA situation, we also need to have a learning and development approach, especially at the leadership level. Let's look at some VUCA drivers. If we take the factor of volatility, the driver for volatility could be demand and prices in a market. And the mitigating approach is to understand the market better, build excess capacity demand, understand break-evens better, and make an effort to reduce the break-even levels that would sustain the organization with good profitability. To be able to do that, we have to have learning capability, analytical capability in the organization and in the leadership. Let's say the factor is uncertainty. What is uncertain in a marketplace? Competition is uncertain. Technology is uncertain. Who will come up with what kind of technology, whether it be a startup or an established company, and at the high end or low end, we are not clear. In such a situation, pick up the competitive signals very fast. Build a technology bank so that you will be able to address foreseeable technological changes. The common factor here again, learning and developing. The factor is complexity, let's say, and the driver could be global nature of our business. In such a case, we have to understand local conditions, redesign products to meet the requirements of every region, and where necessary, relocate manufacture. This requires a learning approach, a research approach, and development approach. And the fourth factor is ambiguity. The drivers for ambiguity are new businesses, new markets, new products, sometimes even new people. It is important to understand business essentials, study markets and customers, and develop technologies. Again, a learning and developing system. VUCA can be handled, certainly, but if you see what is required for VUCA management, we need learning and development as one of the core pillars of a VUCA strategy. The strategy to learn has two implications, because a strategy can be implemented at a gross level. It could also be very nuanced strategy. What is a gross strategy? Where you wield raw functional power, whether of finance, whether of development, whether of manufacturing, we can implement a gross strategic response to a development that is unpredictable in the marketplace. As a result of this gross strategy, however, your performance would be average. On the other hand, if you have a nuanced strategy, the strategy would be segmented not only to the individual factors of VUCA, but also to the segments which are causing such VUCA developments. And this requires learning and exploration about each segment and possible response. Sum of parts performance in such a strategy would be more impactful than trying to have a gross strategy which is common across the VUCA factors. So a new entrant to an established industry could use gross financial power to gain market share or understand various functional factors, and also to understand the relationships, the cause and effect relationships. That could be the first step, but that cannot be the permanent step. Once this gross strategy is utilized to have a foothold of the market and to understand the nature of the market, the company has to quickly move into a nuanced strategy. A particular telecommunication company has entered into the market based on a gross strategy of financial muscle, financial power, and migration of customers based on very attractive pricing plans. It was a gross strategy applicable with raw functional power across the total market. However, if this raw strategy is perpetuated as an institutional perpetual mechanism, it would not lead to any financial results for the benefit of the corporation. That has therefore to be switched to a nuanced strategy, understanding the real voice and data requirements of the customers who have brand loyalty and who do not have brand loyalty for the existing players, and who have brand attraction to the new player. Depending upon the segments, you need to have a more appropriate marketing mix so that you optimize on your resources, but at the same time, you continue with your policy objective of migrating customers from the existing players. This is the essence of learning. Let's look at the Indian telecommunication space in greater detail. Leaders who ignore to explore the future and fail to study the trends do not prepare for VUCA period. They lose out in leading their firms to success. Instead, they land the companies in trouble. Indian telecommunication space is a classic example. We have a population of 1.35 billion. We have 1.2 billion subscribers for telecommunication networks. 600 million internet users are there, and also there is hyper competition. Jio has dominated this market after its entry through a combination of gross strategy at entry and also nuanced strategy thereafter. Reliance Communications has also been one company which has been in existence for several years. Indian telecom companies have been owned by large groups. They had capable leaders, yet many telecommunication firms failed and some have even become bankrupt and left the industry and the marketplace. Why did it happen? For that, the learning and development capability or inclination of the leadership could be seen as the prime driver for such exits from the industry. We compare two firms at the extremes to understand this learning strategy. Reliance Communications versus Reliance Jio. Reliance Communications stayed with Reliance Anil Ambani Group as part of Reliance Business Empire bifurcation. RC was in the telecommunication space from 2002 onwards. On the other hand, Reliance Jio of Mukesh Ambani Group entered the telecommunication space only in 2015, but quickly it became the market leader. RC has become bankrupt and is undergoing IBC proceedings for the last several months, while RJE is redefining the Reliance Mukesh Ambani Group as a flourishing digital company. What are the reasons? Let's look at seven factors. On the factor of technology, Reliance Communications relied on outdated CDMA 2G technology, which probably was outdated even at the time of launch. On the other hand, Reliance Jio started with modern GSM 4G technology with the full preparedness for upgrading to 5G as required. And it established a strong fiber network all across the country. Market entry for Reliance Communications was based on weak telecom circles because they were to fight a licensing regime and have to pay the licensing fees. Typically, the company chose telecom circles which were weak, but that was not helpful when national rollout was permitted for various telecommunication companies. On the other hand, Reliance Jio has planned a pan-India rollout. The platform chosen by Reliance Communications was only voice-based, whereas Reliance Jio chose a data-cum voice-based platform. Investments were always shoestring at Reliance Communications, while the investments of Reliance Jio have been at high level. Financial power for Anil Ambani Group was pretty weak, and all other group enterprises also had weak financials. On the other hand, Reliance Jio had a very strong financial situation. The balance sheet was strong. It could attract enough debt to fund its rollout plans. And there were also huge investor flows in recent times based on the makeover of the company as a telecom giant in India and a potential makeover as a digital company. Execution has been very tardy for Reliance Communications, whereas Reliance Jio followed an agile model which is focused and tight. Marketing by Reliance Communications was defensive and was share losing, whereas Reliance Jio adopted a very aggressive share gaining market strategy. So Reliance Jio is a case of an aggressive competitor turning a stable telecom space into a VUCA space, but gaining from it substantially because Jio learnt, innovated, improvised and invested to edge out the competition, studying carefully the mistakes the competition has made and developing carefully the right moves the company had to move. Strategy therefore needs to learn from competition, and also the leaders need to learn consistently and continuously how to strategize and execute ahead of competition. That is the learning and development need for the organizations as well as the leaders. So what does this learning leading mechanism mean? Isolated and disconnected from functional strategies, despite the payoff, do not reflect the totality of leadership in letter and spirit. A leader has to be fully involved in all the functions of a firm, and couple of firm functions stand out. These functions are technology functions and the management process. These need to be kept in mind by leaders. Then only the hypothesis of leading with learning becomes natural and relevant. Why should we have technology and management as the core of a learning and leading culture? Because these are the pillars for a good corporate strategy. A good corporate strategy generates several options, makes choices, and sets priorities based on technological innovation and operational efficiency. It also ensures that the products and services support the poor and leverage the rich. That is, the market skimming strategy is adopted to the extent of having price advantage for the less privileged sections of the market, and it promotes therefore growth with equity. A good corporate strategy also understands how to compete as also collaborate with other players to be able to sustain overall prosperity for the industry. A corporate strategy of such high standards makes leaders understand that they do also have their limitations, and they need to be in a continuous knowledge seeking mode, development seeking mode, so that they can shape up to the competition that is expected to come, or they themselves shape the competition for others. In doing so, great leaders stay humble, and they always say that they have a lot to learn to be able to improve upon themselves as time moves along. So what do learning leaders do? We have talked about big time leaders, big leaders in terms of learning leadership. But let us look at even a traveling salesperson who is on a leadership journey. His job is to sell products to the customer. But if he thinks that his job is to provide a delightful buying experience for the customer, he has learned to do something value added for the company. And then if he understands the latent consumer needs as he undertakes his selling transaction, he is in a position to provide valuable feedback to the company. And as a result of these three approaches, he converts the unknown unknown of the marketplace to at least a known unknown of the marketplace. And when that happens, he would be serving as the bridge between the company and the consumer. As a result, the salesperson expands the envelope for all the stakeholders. Volume levels are increased, the product count is increased, stocking options are improved, and the understanding of consumer interests deepens. As a result, the traveling salesman creates value for the company. And over a period of time, when he repeats it to a higher level of trajectory, he also stakes leadership claim. So starting the job as a traveling salesperson, he demonstrates that it is not an infratic position. In fact, it is a leadership position. The learning individual becomes a well-noticed leader. Even in the very commoditized sense of a seller doing something at someone else's bidding, there would be several opportunities to enhance one's own as well as others' awareness through a process of expanding the envelope of knowledge and process of expanding the accountability to building company's value chain. And that is the broader cause, and that is the wider society. Even a person at the ground level, at the executive level, has. It is also important to pause to learn. Just as the success in one position does not automatically lead to success in another superior position, knowledge gained in one phase of leadership journey or managerial journey does not necessarily assure equivalent knowledge which can provide equivalent or better success in another higher leadership position. So if you see the organizational pyramid, you can identify three types of responsibility levels. One, functional responsibility. Second is the business responsibility. And third is the overall corporate responsibility. In functional responsibility level, all your impact is in terms of operational efficiency. In respect of business responsibility, you will be measured by strategic effectiveness. And the corporate responsibility involves taking care of the profit and loss accountability for the organization. If you reflect on the breadth of the corporate strategy versus the narrowness of operational tactics, you will understand that what made you successful as an operationally efficient leader need not necessarily make you successful as a business leader or as a corporate leader. However, you need to maintain your knowledge of the operational capability, but move on to add additional learning inputs to your leadership profile. That's how an executive becomes an effective manager, and an effective manager becomes an effective leader. That means there are pause points as the individuals change their phases of career from being an executive to manager, manager to senior manager, and senior manager to aspirant leader, and from an aspirant leader to an effective leader. So some pause to learn better, to learn appropriately and develop oneself appropriately is very much required. So how do we rewire to learn? In all these processes of performance measurement, performance appraisal, learning and development falls by the wayside, unfortunately. It is just one row in the entire long list of performance appraisal activities. Precisely to handle this, the strategy focused organization concept and the balanced scorecard concept have come about. The balanced scorecard gives equal weightage or equitable weightage to financial perspectives, internal business perspectives, customer perspectives, and finally to the innovation and learning perspectives. The balanced scorecard approach creates a direct nexus between learning, innovation, and improvement as a measure of leader effectiveness and organizational effectiveness. So it advocates the ability to launch new products, create more value for customers, and improving the operational efficiency on a continuous basis as accruing from the ability of the leader to constantly and continuously update his capabilities and knowledge. Therefore, balanced scorecard is one tool that the organizations have to apply a learning and development culture in the organization. Another methodology for continuous learning and development is to view the business in short, medium and long term. If you plot the requirements of the business on two dimensions, one is step up in the characteristics and two, level up in the scale of innovation, you will find that in the short term, the characteristics that need to be stepped up are not many and the scale up of innovation is also not very high. However, you need continuous improvement and you have to accumulate knowledge and experience from the operational stages so that you can use those inputs to perform better, consolidate your business further. That is the learning agenda for the short term. In the medium term, you are required to follow the trends that are visible. For example, the new competition that is coming up, new products that are getting introduced, and the economic factors that are undergoing some change. And you have to master the emerging horizons of knowledge to deepen or diversify the firm's business. Diversification and deepening of the firm's capability start in the medium term in a big way. And for that, again, a new way of understanding the new characteristics that are required for the business and the scale of innovation required for the business is essential. And finally, the learning for the long term. This requires new fundamental planks of knowledge that can anticipate the new mega trends and prepare the firm. So a firm is what it sees itself as being comprised within a set of boundaries. Similarly, a leader is also one who is cocooning himself or herself in the boundaries he or she sets for the leadership. It is important, therefore, that you have a multi-layered boundary system, a boundary system that ensures that you consolidate and refine the short term, a second level of boundary system which helps you move on to the medium term, bring in the new aspects of specialization and diversification for the business and the products and the technologies, and finally, probably an unbounded horizon wherein you continuously explore new technologies, new products, new services, new ways of doing business so that the organization can be prepared for the really long-term horizon. To be able to do that, we have to believe that learning and development are not two separate things, but they are one integral interlocked system. That learning is required to develop oneself is rather easily understood, but not many understand that one has to develop oneself to be in a frame of mind to accept learning continuously and also develop oneself continuously. So a self-learning and self-development mindset is extremely important. You may have intrinsic inputs and applications. You may also have extrinsic inputs and applications, but you need to have a learning approach so that you are knowledgeable and you have a focused mindset, you have a spirit of inquiry, and you have a spirit of understanding the developments. That is all the learning part. But you should appreciate the development part because knowledge per se doesn't lead to change in practical impact. You got to be impactful in the practical marketplace or in the workshop. To be able to do that, you must know how to apply the knowledge and become a better person. That requires most times a broader personality outlook. To be able to have this learning and development interlocked system is one of the key requirements for every manager and a leader. This helps a person be receptive, be perceptive, notice the mega trends, and understand the impact of big data as you go on the learning and development mode. And that is the only viable methodology to stay ahead in people-driven and technology-driven product and services businesses. One must invest one's personal time as well to constantly update oneself and be on a mode of learning and development. You should not expect that everything will be done by the organization. You need to develop yourself on your own on certain aspects of professional and personal life. And the fact that you are enrolled in this program and you are keen to learn not only probably this subject, but several other subjects reflects very well on your interest to learn and develop and contribute to yourself as well as to the organizations. So let's understand learning and development in little greater detail. Although they look pretty self-explanatory, let's understand. Once, the process of acquiring knowledge and absorbing it is learning. It can be formal, that is knowledge with degrees, or informal, just for the sake of knowledge. It can be in attendance or it can be in virtual system. Development is the process of applying knowledge into sustainable positive behaviors and practices. When we say positive behaviors, the behavior of the individual who is undergoing the learning experience and also the team members who are working with the individual. Similarly, the work practices need to be evolved and developed to be able to impact through the learning exercise via the development route. Again, development can be structured based on a specific plan or unstructured based on random application. It is important to eliminate the artificial and incorrect differentiation between learning and development. In academic programs, we try to bridge these two through theory and practical experimentation. Even within theory, we try to have better theory through assignments, lecture sessions, and project works. But in practical situation, we are so much in pursuit of day-to-day results that we forget to learn from whatever is happening around us and in our departments and in our functions. To resolve that, we must understand how learning can be absorbed and how development can be reflected. We have three examples here. Ratan Tata, from learning to transformation. Ratan Tata was chosen by J.R.D. Tata to succeed him in 1991. Ratan Tata joined Tata Group in 1962 as an apprentice at Tata Steel in Jamshedpur. After working for 9 years, he was asked to take over the operations of National Radio and Electronics Company, NELCO. NELCO was a maker of radios, radiograms, and some other engineering products at that point of time. Turning around the loss-making unit was the test given to him. He was appointed in 1971 as director in charge of NELCO, which was truly an ailing Tata Group firm in radio business, and radio at that point in time was considered high technology and a consumer product as well. When Ratan Tata took over, NELCO had a 2% market share in the consumer electronics market with a loss margin of 40% of sales. He turned around the company from 1972 to 1975. NELCO touched a market share of 20%, tenfold increase. It also recovered all of its losses. Ratan Tata recommended that NELCO should invest in developing high technology products rather than consumer electronics. That means he has learned the business, the underlying technology, the underlying business implications thoroughly, even as he did the day job of turning around the company with the inherited product market space. That is the learning experience which Tata had, and that learning he utilized to transform NELCO. While the change was not immediately made then by Tata Group, clearly, Ratan Tata was futuristic in foreseeing the importance of high technology telecommunications. Today, NELCO is a leader in VSAT, satellite-based communication systems, and it serves a very wide range of industries. And Ratan Tata himself went on to become the chairman of Tata Group, transforming the group itself. Great leaders, as demonstrated by Ratan Tata, are adept at learning and grasping new things and reinventing their leadership personalities and business profiles continuously. As a result, they excel in looking beyond the current task and leading into the future. This is one inspirational example of how a leader can continuously learn to transform himself and also the organization he heads. And the organization could be just one company or it could be a conglomerate. Another example of Azim Premji, development and diversification through learning. Azim Premji was born into a business family. His father had established Western India Vegetable Products that dealt in hydrogenated oil manufacturing at that time. Azim was studying in Stanford University at that point of time and he had no plans of moving into business. In 1966, upon his father's death, the then 20-year-old Azim Premji returned to India to take charge of the company. He first stabilized and expanded the hydrogenated oil manufacturing business. After that, he diversified into strategic adjacencies. He diversified into bakery fats, ethnic ingredient-based toiletries, hair care soaps, and baby toiletries. You can see the consumer footprint getting expanded and also both technological and market adjacencies being explored by him. It is one level of learning which he has put into practice. Then he started applying the engineering approach to diversification. He diversified into lighting products and hydraulic cylinders, again two ends of electromechanical devices. In the 1980s, he recognized the importance of the emerging IT field. That was the point of inflection in strategic learning and strategic thought, for Azim Premji. He changed the company name to Wipro in 1984 and entered the high technology sector, manufacturing mini computers under technical collaboration. Later on, he diversified into IT services and engineered a dramatic shift of Wipro from soaps to software. Soaps continued, but software also continues, and that is the dominant business of Wipro today. And Wipro for long has been the top three bellwethers of Indian information technology industry. He continuously learned, he continuously put that learning into practice. He developed his core businesses and also diversified into futuristic businesses. Azim Premji did not ignore the roots of family business. He, however, grasped the mega trends and moved into high technology manufacturing and futuristic information technology services, building a great future for Wipro. He had personal loss. He had a shocking surprise with the demise of the father. Yet, he collected all his energy, all his fortitudes, and all his knowledge to be able to expand his core business and also diversify into futuristic businesses. Another example, excellent example of learning to lead. The third example I have is one of Sunil Mittal, chairman of Bharti Airtel. He was very intuitive about telecom. Sunil Mittal was born into a business family. The business family's interests were in trading, and his own entrepreneurial businesses focused on export-import operations, dealing in automotive components and generator sets. When import of generator sets was banned in 1983 by the government of India, his business had existential crisis. He was the first to spot the mobile telecom opportunity in India in the 1990s. His first business in 1976 was to make crankshafts for cycles. He established in 1980 import-export business relating to cycle parts and generator sets. Later on in 1984, he spotted the opportunity to make push-button telephones for the Indian telecom sector. In 1992 again, soon after economic liberalization, he spotted the opportunity in mobile telephone services and was the first amongst a few people to secure the licenses. He established Bharti Cellular in 1995 to offer cellular telephone services under the brand name Airtel. He kept up an aggressive pace of modernization, expansion, and overseas acquisition. From push-button phones in 1984 to cellular telephone services in 1995 and a market-leading position despite the severe competition offered by Reliance Jio, Airtel speaks very highly of the founder's learning and development instincts. Airtel still has 350 million mobile subscribers to its credit. Sunil Mittal made bold choices all the time to enter the highly regulated, highly technology intensive and investment intensive telecommunication field. He understood the importance of the telecommunication field for national growth. He also understood the critical competitive conditions that could exist in telecommunication field, and from time to time buttressed the position of the company. He learned to keep pace with technology and retain dominance. Next to Jio, we can say that Airtel has equally strong technological capabilities and marketing capabilities, despite not having the same gross financial power which the Reliance Jio group had. This is the third example. He was intuitive about telecom, and while being intuitive, he also learned about the field, applied his knowledge, and developed a totally new and formidable foundation for growing the telecommunication business. These are the three powerful examples of leaders learning and constantly developing their businesses, and also in that process going into higher levels of learning to be able to take their businesses to even higher levels. There are some related impacts of learning and development. The challenges of learning and development are stiffer for leaders. The differences become acute because the learning process for leaders require not only mind and heart, but they require mind, heart, as well as the gut. We talked about the physiology model of leadership, saying that head, heart, and guts are required to be able to be an effective leader. Head for the brain power, logical power, analytical power, conceptual power, in fact, all the performance-oriented leadership attributes. Heart is required for developmental performance attributes, the soft portion of the leader. And guts is a combination of factors from both these parameters. And when you have a robust physiological model of head, heart and gut, you will be able to be an effective leader. So what is the difference between learning and development for a leader? Learning makes the individual knowledgeable, but development makes the individual impactful for his or her ecosystem. There is no point in being an erudite leader. You must be an erudite leader who is able to translate all the erudition into practice. That is the requirement. Learning requires a focused and targeted mindset that is milestone driven. Development demands a broader personality outlook that applies individual learning to team or social betterment. Learning by yourself is not enough in the case of a leader. The leader has to spread or diffuse his learning across his team. Learning requires verification of knowledge received and is repeatable, whereas development gets verified only through its application and the outcomes, and incorrect application may not be easily corrected. Learning tends to be generic and multi-domain, whereas development tends to be very context-specific and very specialized. Great leaders are also adept at learning and grasping new things, applying the learning in the developmental practice, and reinventing their leadership personalities continuously. There was a manager of internal audit in an automobile company who came in from fast-moving consumer goods background. His first project as the head of internal audit was not financial transaction accounting or auditing. His first job as internal auditor was to understand the efficiencies in heat treatment furnaces of the factory. As a result of his study, he could find that the carburization times taken were far too long and were also leading to imperfections in the product quality, and he came up with a solution to have optimal heat treatment conditions and optimal heat treatment furnace operations. It made such an impact on the manufacturing psyche of the company and also on the leadership's outlook towards internal audit that he had a strong, rapid growth path and eventually ended up as the managing director of the automobile corporation. So great leaders are always adept at learning and grasping new things, applying the learning in developmental practice and reinventing their leadership personalities continuously. What are the features of learning and development? First of all, the fundamental feature is that you have to learn to develop and you have to develop to learn. This approach has the greatest potential to ensure a leadership bench that is both broad and deep. So the key metric for learning and development is in terms of the development impact the learning processes provide, and not just the incremental knowledge that is provided in the workshop, that is the learning workshop. More than learning, therefore, development needs to be seen as the tangible outcome, and it also requires continuous reinforcement from one's own inner self as also from the peers and the broader organization. As one becomes aged biologically, development requires more of learning approach rather than just knowledge acquisition. There's no point in trying to have formal degrees and formal education. You need to adopt the continuous learning mechanisms as you are doing so that your knowledge level increases in a very exponential fashion and also in a manner in which it can be flexibly adapted to individual work situations. Learning typically peaks through the teens till the early career, while true development peaks all through the career span, particularly through the mid-career, and it remains active till the end of the active career. The greater the biological overlap between learning and development, the greater would be the natural progression of leadership. We said that learning is up to the mid-career and development takes over from mid-career. It doesn't mean that there is no development during the early career, nor that there would be no learning in the post-mid-career situation. However, if the overlap between learning and development is high all through, then the leader would be really an effective leader and he or she would have a very natural and impactful progression of leadership. In technology learning especially, we need to focus on mega trends. It's not about learning Python language or another language. It's also the trend of analyzing how these languages structure newer applications which supports the newer themes in information technology and digital technology field. it is good to know coding, but it is more important to know how the codes will be utilized in creating new systems and new products, new devices and new services. So fundamentally, we should understand how new technologies would redefine industries and societies, and the trends and requirements of employment that would be impacted by that. When I say the trends and requirements of employment, I don't mean the employees who will be replaced by these new technologies. I would be meaning employees who would be required to develop the new products and services based on these new technologies and the requirements of maintaining those new products and services. Leaders should learn to grasp the implications of such technological developments and need not necessarily focus on learning the technologies by themselves. They should understand the paths of technology development so that they can lead their organizations on such paths while minimizing the social angst. Proactive leaders not only perceive such megatrends, but they even influence them. Because they are ahead in technological development, they are also ahead in preparing their businesses and their organizations for newer technologies. It is a self-learning and self-development mindset that makes leaders bring in megatrends. If you are always watching megatrends that are developed by someone else, and if you are only constantly watchful of the competitive trends, you are really not influencing the marketplace. So a self-development and self-learning mindset, which makes you the influencer, preferably the developer of megatrends, is what is required in technology learning space. We need to be therefore perceptive about these technologies and utilize them appropriately. Conceptualization, triggering and influencing of megatrends is one of the most viable and important ways for becoming an industry leader. We can also learn a lot by big data. With quantum jumps in sensing, telecommunication and computing technologies, big data has moved from supporting operational efficiency to a whole new spectrum of machine maintenance, manufacturing system optimization and product design. Leaders need to learn the power of technology at work, but retain human leadership. Apple Watch had taken a great step in learning the movement sensitivity of an individual and detecting the fall propensity and the actual fall of an individual and alerting emergency services. That has been a great step. But deploying big data, the stability and the balance of the individual can be analyzed over a period of time, and a suitable advisory could be issued both to the individual and also to the family members, and where necessary to the doctor, so that the pattern is understood. Whether there is any neurological symptom underlying the movement patterns, the balance patterns of an individual is the next step. And how does that happen? It happens by the use of big data. From the aeroplane, we have flying performance, trillions of data bits. From the machining center, we have the machining performance. From the autonomous automobile, we have the driving and traffic data. From the sensors, we have got huge amount of capability for sense very precise movements. Telecommunications provide you unprecedented global level big data. Computers can analyze data in a jiffy. In this situation, clearly there is a revolution that is sweeping the industrial system without being visible. Machine tools are getting redesigned based on big data. General Electric is able to redesign its wind turbines and other specialist products based on the trillions of data bits collected when the products are in operation. Human interactions are themselves lending to countless signal interfaces, as I already discussed, that provide valuable inputs to the participants in their self-active and interactive process. Unfortunately, humans themselves are becoming more robotic than robots in understanding the importance of data. We should be able to analyze through our human sensibilities and sensitivities where else data can be collected from, how much of data we can collect, and how deeply we can analyze the data. So we should supplement the capabilities of signal recognition and signal processing with our own judgment, so that human interactions can be taken to higher level. Human Internet of Things can be taken to the higher level. to be able to do that, leaders must have the singular responsibility for being perceptive on data analytics as much as on digital analytics. They must be perceptive on human analytics as much as they are emphasizing machine analytics. This is the combination which a leader must look at. So what is the leader's need for learning based on whatever we have seen? Technology disruptions must be learned proactively. Business disruptions must be understood and the leader must be prepared for. And what are the barriers to leader learning? It is fairly simple to understand that technology disruptions would come, business disruptions would come. The barriers are ego state due to the performance, and the ego state that is further exasperated by the deafening of leaders. So it is important for leaders to demolish these barriers. We should have a zero ego state as leaders. That doesn't mean we are not proud of our achievements, but we should not have ego that develops out of genuine pride. We should discourage deafening of leaders. Leaders must be seen as normal individuals, even if they possess those 30 unique parameters we have discussed earlier. That is the removal of barriers, which is essential for leader learning. Then the leaders must also have open and reflective minds. They should never rest on their laurels. They should be humble enough to study newness and at times openly agree that they are ignorant about those new trends and be willing to be stewards and must be willing to be apprentices to learn these new technologies. True learning and development occurs when human minds are reflective enough not to bask in their past glories, but be open and humble enough to understand opportunities and challenges of the future and reshape oneself. This alone would enable leaders to become receptive and perceptive, to foresee and shape megatrends on one hand, as well as leverage technology and analytics on the other hand to improve industrial and social life. Every new activity we undertake leads to a lot of learning. And as long as we do not have barriers to learning, we will enormously benefit from such learning episodes. The other learning episode comes from whatever is happening in the emerging marketplace, the way the smartphones are being used, the way e-commerce is being conducted, the way OTT streaming is taking place, the way Internet of Things is pushing itself to various aspects of our life, the way the digital payments have expanded, both through demonetization as well as because of COVID situation, contactless behavior. The way working or learning from home or anywhere else is happening. Huge levels of virtual contacts and perpetual data development is happening. We have embraced modern technological developments unhesitatingly in this process, whether it is smartphones or e-commerce, digital payments or learning from home. We have been very quick in adaptation to these activities. India therefore offers great potential for leaders to combine technology with social purpose all the time. You can see that all of these activities have kept the wheels of life moving without any feeling that the life has come to a halt. The same mindset, the same growth mindset would drive the introduction of newer developments based on newer technologies, and leaders must be willing to first learn to move out of their comfort zones, continuously learn new technologies and new developments, embrace the mega trends and bring them to fruition in actual practical place. For nations, firms and leaders, it is not a question of where one was originally ordained to start the growth journey, but a matter of how they all through their journey learn to develop and develop to learn in terms of themselves and others. It doesn't matter whether India started its industrialization several years later than other countries. It doesn't even matter if a neighboring country is ahead of us in the industrial development. What is relevant is that in the leadership journey, in the developmental journey we have pursued, we as leaders, we as individuals, we as organizations must learn to develop and also develop to learn. Only when that happens, we will be able to accelerate our growth path with both social justice as well as economic development. To be able to do that, we should focus on the skills that are required. The brain and mind skills which we need to develop vary depending upon the level of management we are in. If we are in frontline management, we need basic technical and compliance skills. If we are in middle management, we need to have the basic and technical and compliance skills, but also acquire additional conceptual, analytical and relational skills. And if we move to the senior management, all these skills are required to be there, but we also need to have the transformational skills of judgment, creativity, planning and problem solving. Moving to a higher level doesn't mean that the original skills which were helpful in the previous journeys of professional life are no longer required. They are required probably to a lesser degree, but the newer skills will be equally important to power the initial movement in that new position. So we require business driven planning for talent in a holistic manner. All the learning and development programs in an organization must focus on these three levels of brain and mind skills, which every individual must have. We should also have five core skills, and that should form a good alchemy. We should have conceptual skills, that is reducing the complex to simple. What does it mean to have chatbots in our service infrastructure? What does it mean to have a GPS system that can reach out to all my truck drivers, irrespective of whether they use my trucks or other trucks? What is the complexity involved and how can I make it simple? The conceptual skills. Then analytical skills, which are logical and data-based, ability to analyze alternate paths and come up with the best solution. Technical skills to make whatever business model you have developed a feasible, viable one. It is developmental and constructive skills. You should have creative skills, that is the ability to dream of new solutions to the problems that are encountered, or ability to discover problems and come up with solutions. And finally, integrative end-to-end skills. When you make a change in the product, ability to imagine what would happen through the manufacturing, through vendor development, and finally at customer hands. That end-to-end capability to envisage the change you make in any one particular feature of the product or service in terms of the total value chain impact, that is the end-to-end capability. An individual who achieves mastery over these five sets of core skills would evolve as a good leader. We also need to be conscious of the combination of soft and hard skills. What are soft skills? We looked at the development performance attributes. Those soft skills are personality driven. They are highly individual specific. These are conditioned by the ecosystem. We considered in the previous lecture how our genetics as well as our family background, our friendship circles influence our soft skill approach. We are also influenced by our core values in the soft skill set, and these are all experiential. But the important thing about soft skills is that they are difficult to acquire, but they are hard to lose. So if you get the right type of soft skills ingrained in you, these would stay with you forever almost. Then the hard skills, which are usually technical and specific. They are highly domain specific. They are prone to obsolescence. They need continuous fortification. Just as the languages of the past, Fortran and C, are no longer relevant, and you have Pythons and other modern languages. Similarly, how the enterprise resource planning systems have moved from the original systems to the more modern digital systems. It is all a matter of continuous updation, and at times step function increase the level of technical knowledge or the professional knowledge. And these are related usually to the core functional areas such as design, manufacturing, quality, information technology and marketing. The point about hard skills, in contrast to the soft skills, are they are easy to lose. With lapse of time, those skills also may become outdated, and they are difficult to acquire. While soft skills are hard to lose once they are ingrained in your personality, hard skills are easy to lose and difficult to acquire, which means you need to have continuous learning as a process, continuous learning as a mindset, so that you minimize the loss of hard skills and you constantly update them as and when it is required. The combined skills, that is the hard skills and soft skills combined, supplement and reinforce each other, and that is an alchemy that is formidable. In people and technology driven quality consulting business, for example, the essentiality of soft and hard skills bring together an individual, a competence that cannot be easily ignored, because quality, like safety, is a behavior pattern. So you should have soft skills to get quality mindset ingrained in an individual, even as you understand what it means to do a good analytical testing, what it means to write a good standard operating practice, what it means to have appropriate sterile filling practices. All of these are hard skills which are necessary, but it is also necessary to have in the same individual soft skills of project management, interpersonal training, and behavior upgradation. So a combination would make somebody unbeatable. And we should also look at passion. We talked about passion as one of the developmental performance attribute. Passion gives us purpose and focus. It keeps us focused on goals and results. It leads to competency and competitiveness. It also is reflected in terms of aptitude and attitude. It is marked by introspection and reflection, sensitivity and sensibility to what one is doing, logic and perspective. Some of these factors not only strengthen passion, some of these things not only are driven by passion, some of these factors which I have mentioned make you dispassionate when it is required, especially introspection and reflection, being sensitive and sensible, being logical and having a perspective make you dispassionate when you encounter issues. You understand through your dispassion whether it is still worthwhile to be passionate and try your best to overcome the hurdles, or you should have a newer pivot to achieve your goals. That is the advantage of these behavior traits, which I have linked as further amplification of passion. Passion manifests itself in many forms, but mostly it is a positive and constructive individual behavior which every leader must possess. Finally, we have neuroscience as an optimizer. We have to think of our own neuroscientific approach. We have, all of us, have left brain functionalities which are logical, analytical, and objective. We also have our right brain functionalities which are intuitive, thoughtful, and subjective. Ideally, we should have both left brain functionalities and the right brain functionalities. That is, we should be logical and intuitive. We should be analytical and thoughtful. We should be objective and subjective, both. And leadership optimization involves two leader personalities, one predominantly left brain and the other predominantly right brain, jointly sharing in one leadership role collaboratively to bring about a winning fusion of top-notch leadership performance. That requires a high level of self-learning, self-development, self-awareness capability on the part of a leader, and an eagerness along with humility to learn whatever one can from the environment, from formal and informal education processes, with the objective of being a wise and effective leader ahead of others, and also in the process taking the organization ahead of other organizations. By combining analytics and experience, intuition and instinct, the leader is bound to turn in superior performance for himself or herself and the organization he or she heads. Thank you. We'll meet in the next lecture.